Hi, I'm Mark Armini. Welcome to the seventh in my video series on Gene Wolfe and literature. Today we're going to be talking about Seven American Nights in the Book of the Short Sun, quite appropriately. First, I'd like to real briefly mention that my ebook on the study of Gene Wolfe's fiction, Between Light and Shadow, has been released, and so I'll provide a link at the bottom of this for that. First, I'd like to start with a little bit of anecdotal story. Because Book of the Short Sun is one of those really divisive works in discussion amongst Gene Wolfe fans. And it's really the first work that I felt like I really had my own solution for after reading it for the first time back, you know, at 2000, 2001 when those books originally came out. One of the things that I really wanted to emphasize is that not everyone agrees on this particular reading, and that's okay. But I would like to provide some evidence for my reading and delineate it from there. So, I'd like to begin with the story of Eratosthenes. Once upon a time, he looked into a well, and he watched as the shadows moved there. And from that, without any telescope or any kind of external knowledge to the system, he was able to estimate the distance to the sun and the circumference of the earth. And this was in about the 3rd century BC. Then you had hundreds of years, even though it's something of an exaggeration, hundreds of years where people really didn't understand the cosmology of the earth, right? Is it round? Is it flat? Are we going to fall off if we travel too far? So I always like to present my reading of the Book of the Short Sun kind of like Eratosthenes looking in that well. Not everybody is going to see the same thing, but I have at least the suspicion that most of my assertions on this are correct. So, I am also going to provide a link to my analysis of Seven American Nights, which is very complicated to go over in this particular way. We reviewed it a little bit last time. In this, a Persian or Iranian visitor to the United States and kind of this fallen America comes. And it's his journal over the course of his ostensibly 7 days there. However, as you read this journal, you begin to think, gee, where exactly is Nadan, the main character? Because he gets these hallucinogenic eggs, he travels around, and it seems as if he's in danger, and the final day is almost this phantasmagoric experience he has, where he's with a girl, and he might have killed her with a laser pistol of some kind, and it's really unclear exactly what's happened to him. Has he been arrested? Has he been executed? But there are a few things that we can map onto this story that really make sense of it. One of them, I think, was first noticed by David Tallman of the Earth Mailing List and the Wolf Wiki, is that if you count the nights, right, there are six of them. And obviously, people realized this before Tallman, but his explanation was pretty good for this. During his stay there, he says he's going to excise some parts of the journal that are his reason for going there. So if you look at the night descriptions, two of the nights seem to blend together because it's dark outside, and then later on that same night, it's getting dark outside. And this is the same day when he was supposed to go to the Smithsonian. So you can see that perhaps his reason for being there is related to that Smithsonian visit, and that he just chopped it out without regard for this small discrepancy in the journal. Another issue is that there's this little machine that will copy the style of whatever subject or text that you give it. So this story occurs during Holy Week, right? And if you look, there are some indications that Nadan is actually arrested on Maundy Thursday, right, where Christ will have the Last Supper, and that that last day is actually a fabrication in his journal where Christ is put to death. So that final day might be just that story of the machine trying to finish it out, thus that werewolf imagery with Artis, right, where he kills her. So you really get the sense that the government was trying to perhaps poison him with that hallucinogenic drug that he bought. The other backdrop of this is that America is very famous for its chemicals, right? It's a master of hallucinogens and drugs and other treatments, and that something has gone wrong with that and wound up mutagenically poisoning the survivors of the United States. But the hint is that they still have those chemicals. And in this particular story, you have a very strange character who's a grain merchant. His name's Golem Gassum, right? And over the course of this, you see that originally Nadan comes to America on the ship that has Gassum's grain. And he has a dream, a vision of bread being made. And this mystical bread is something that the Americans desire. And later on, he gets in a discussion with the curator of the museum who says, ah, yes, smell is the true essence of a man or anything, right? You take his chemicals inside you and then you experience it. So the real indication here is that this bread of Gollum Gassum, when it's prepared, is actually going to perhaps poison the people that it's distributed to in Europe, in the Middle East, and other places. So this plot of America to rise up again involves this bread. They're kind of preparing it so that there's a beggar who says in this particular text, and he lisps, he says, someday we'll be great again, right? But he confuses his M's and his N's. So Sunday will be great again, kind of like that Easter Sunday resurrection. But in this particular case, it doesn't apply to Nadan, who's probably arrested on Maundy Thursday. So I'm including a link, as I said, to this below. Now we're going to go on to the Book of the Short Sun. In this particular story, they are already on Blue. So at the end of the Book of the Long Sun, Patera Quetzal, right, or Quetzal, if I wanted to say it as probably someone in the United States would. Quetzal, the leader of the church in Viron, decides that they're going to green, right? And if you read some of the prophecies and the auguries in the Book of the Long Sun, there is an unnamed person who brings a sacrifice. And Matera Mint reads it, and she says, I just see forks. And it's pretty clear when you reread it that the unnamed person providing the sacrifice right before Patera Quetzal appears in the later scene is actually him, and that he views everyone on the world as food to some degree. So that's what that particular augury means. So his decision to take them to green, when you actually see green in the Book of the Short Sun, it's like a hell, right? So they decide to go to Blue, the kind of sister planet there. And Blue is a little bit colder than green, and it's scarcely populated. There's a lot of water and islands and things like this. And Horn and his family kind of settle there, right, in New Viron. And at this particular point, they decide, oh, things are going bad. We need Patera Silk. Horn, you need to go find him and save him. And when you read the first volume of the Book of the Short Sun on Blue's waters, you find that he says strange things, right? He's like, I'm the only one who can't tell you where Silk is. Because for some reason, people keep confusing him with Silk, even though they look nothing alike. Somehow, it seems as if Horn has wound up in Silk's body. And if he is not purely Horn, there's the hint that Silk is in there somewhere. Because there are little mistakes, he said, like, oh yes, at that point, hide and Horn, my children. You know, he's naming himself as one of his children, and this is not something that a man normally does. This isn't the kind of mistake that people make in general when they're misnaming something. So he's a little bit confused all through that first volume of On Blue's Waters. Now, I have emphasized in the past that Gene really likes to load up a lot of the imagery and the important symbolism in the very opening chapter. So, for example, in the original opening chapter of the Book of the New Sun, Severian was obsessed with this miraculous light, this flambeau that was going to come. And he was also obsessed with the idea that when this light struck, it would kind of make this brush come to life and run up a tree and you know, eyes would sprout in this inanimate matter. And that seems like kind of a foreshadowing of the Green Man. So that's very important for the entire solar cycle. However, in the first chapter of Book of the Short Sun on Blue's Waters, we get a lot of the same kind of mysterious dialogue that I really wanted to take a specific look at here. So, they explain to him that because of bad weather and crops, the seed that they have is giving out, right? You know, that something bad is happening here. And they're talking about how they really need a stronger breed of corn. So I'm just going to read this, and it'll make sense in a minute. Let's talk about maize for the present. It's the most important and the clearest example. Back home, we had ever so many kinds. Do you remember, Horn? I nodded, smiling. At least four kinds of yellow maize that I can remember, and it wasn't something I paid much attention to. Then there were black, red, and blue, and several sorts of white. Have any of you boys ever seen maize that wasn't yellow? And then it says you get the best maize by crossing two strains. Some crosses are better than others, as you'd expect, but the best ones will yield a lot more than either of the original two. Fight off blight and need less water. And then you get this explanation. The crop after the first is liable to be worse than either of the strains you crossed. In fact, and it's always worse than the parent strain, the one from the crossing. So he's saying that the first generation of this crossing is going to be worse than either parent strain. And then at the bottom, it goes on to talk about where they are. We call this world blue and call our sun here the short sun. Sure. At home, we called the world our ancestors came from the short sun world. Your mother will remember that, I'm sure, and I remember talking with Patera Silk about all the wisdom and science that we left behind there. And then Hyde, after a while, says, I don't see what any of this has to do with maize. It has everything to do with it. I was about to say that when Pass stalked the Landers, it was on that earlier short sun whirl. He was a god there, you see, and I think probably the greatest. Since he was, he's capable of becoming a god here, too, although he hasn't done it, or at least hasn't let us know he's done it yet. So this first chapter presents the idea that crossing these strains will result in a worse generation, and that it somehow mystically has everything to do with the location of the worlds right here. Now, Horn, in that first book, is clearly narrating events of the past when he goes off to find Silk and his kind of Odysseus-like journey there. And he runs into Matera Marble and Mucor on their island. And she gives him a prophecy that says, I see you, Horn, riding a beast with three horns. So throughout this entire narrative, right, we have a situation where we're ostensibly looking for Silk. However, at the very end of the first book, right, which I'm going to jump to now, you get this situation where Horn takes a pause for the night. And this is in the future narrative, right, where he seems to be in a different body and people are mistaking him for Silk. He's a Rajan of Gon at this point, so he's already kind of transported through space and wound up in Silk's body and then come back to Blue. Another halt, and this one must be for the night. A hollow among the roots of what I will say is just such a tree as we had on Green. It's what we call a very big tree here, in other words. I will write, I suppose, as long as the light lasts. I have three, no four more sheets of paper. And then so he's under this tree and he says, goodbye again, Nettle. I've always loved you. Goodbye, Sinew, my son. May the outsider bless you as I do. In the years to come, remember your father and forget our last quarrel. Goodbye, Hoof. Goodbye, Hyde. Be good boys. Obey your mother until you're grown and cherish her always. And then it says, I found him in the forest, sitting in the dark under the trees. I could not see him. It was too dark to see anything. But I knelt beside him and laid my head upon his knee, and he comforted me. And then we have this strange scene where Horn is being called Babby, right? The Huss. And then even a little bit later after this, like about a page over, you have a different voice saying, I've reread most of this, not all but most. There are many things I ought to have written less about, and a few about which I should have written more. Harry Mouse's smile, how it lights his face, how cheerful he is when everything is bad and getting worse. And then he says, I didn't talk about this, this, and this, and I should have. And then finally, on this last paragraph in the book, it says, little space left. I'm ashamed of many things I've done, but not of how I've lived my lives. I snatched the ball and won the game. I should have been more careful, but what if I had been? What then? We know from the very opening chapter of Long Sun that Silk catches the ball, and that's when he receives his enlightenment. So here he's saying, he caught the ball and won the game. This is Silk. At this point, Horn sat under that tree, right? And he says goodbye and he actually leaves and he goes into Babby. But you don't realize that on the first read-through. Horn, at this point, is no longer Silkhorn. He's out of the picture. And from there on, you get Silk in denial. So every time he denies being Silk, he cannot accept the fact that his student, his surrogate child, right, who imitated him so well and patterned his life off of him, has sacrificed himself so that Silk might live. He can't accept it, so he says, no, I'm Horn, I'm not Silk. This self-abnegation continues throughout the entire text. And if you look at the character list at the beginning of In Green's Jungles, it no longer lists Horn as the protagonist. It says a papermaker of New Viren appointed to bring Silk to Blue. At the beginning of On Blue's Waters, It did. It listed him as the protagonist. So he's left the picture. In addition, the narrative thrust of In Green's Jungle comes to the present. And when he has to tell about Horn, he changes voices, right? When he tells that story of Horn on Green there, he actually changes the voice and says, he did this, he did that. It's no longer first person. And this is a huge hint that our narrator is actually Silk in Denial from the second volume to the end, instead of Horn, who is now in Babby. And later on, when they go to the Red Sun, right, the Earth, basically, when they visit that in their astral travels, you see a scene where Babby looks very human. And Horn's child is assaulted by one of the sailors on the ship. And Babby gets extremely furious, and he throws the sailor down, and he hugs his son. He hugs Horn's son, right? And he says, ha ha ha. Now, Wolf has trained us to understand that whenever Babby says that, that's the only way, that's the only thing he can say. But here he's pointing at his tusks, and he's trying to say, I'm Horn, I'm your father, right? So under that tree the same as they had on Green, Horn transmigrates into Babby. And when Windcloud comes in Dorp at this one particular trial and says, ah yes, Silk and Horn, I knew them both, they lived in my house. Remember, Babby is a Huss, and Huss, the term huswife, that just means housewife. So in the final analysis, Babby is a house that stores Horn's spirit, and that's where he winds up, the beast with three horns. It's got two tusks or two horns, and then Horn himself inside it. Now, another thing that is a little bit controversial is originally, when the end of Long Sun came about and you saw, you know, a blue and a green world there, everyone said, oh gee, is this going to be Earth? Have they returned to Earth? And then as the text went on, it seemed less and less likely, especially when they astral travel to the planet Earth, and it seems as if this is the start of Severian's story instead of the end after the Flood and it becoming Ushis. One of the things that is most controversial about my reading is that I believe that Wolf set it up so that at first you would think it was Earth and Loon, and then as you start to try and map it on there, you simply cannot do it. However, there is still a way, using that information from the first chapter, hybridization, to account for the changes, this vast changes, this kind of polyploid life where they have multiple limbs, right? The life cycle there is not on the schematics of, you know, bipedal organisms like ourselves. There's extra limbs, and there is a point where Horn falls into this giant pit on an island, and right before that, or perhaps after it in the text, he's shocked in the storm when he sees that the island chain that he's looking at is composed of giant ferns, and it terrifies him for some reason. On Green, you have these trees that eat trees that eat trees, these cannibal trees, and it says that they've solved every problem except for the liana vines that parasitize them. So in this particular reading of the Book of the Short Sun, we have this island as a giant tree, as on Green, that kind of consumes Horn, and then hybridizes with them, just like the corn in the first chapter there, to create a strain that is different and distinct from both parent strains. And this idea that vegetable matter and blood are somehow responsible for a new generation is actually something that is included in the Eucharist scene that Silk performs in the forest. So he's in the forest, and he pretty much enacts, right, the Eucharist of the Catholic Church. I'm just going to review the verbiage of the standard ceremony there, where, you know, it kind of reenacts the Last Supper, where Jesus, and this is what the priest says, he took the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you. And then he took the cup filled with the fruit of the vine and gave the cup to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me. So you actually have Silk enacting this Eucharist scene in the forest, and he says they were watching, this they behind him. Well, who's in the forest? Right? The vanished gods of Green. Those giant trees back there are watching him. When Horn's son Sinew dies on Green, the trees weep. So you have all this strange imagery associated with the trees. When someone goes into the forest with an axe, right, the vanished people, the neighbors appear, and they look at them as if they're angry. So there's some kind of innate relationship between these trees and the vanished people. And it could very well be that through the blood, right, because in the Catholic Church, the transubstantiation of the Eucharist is that the vegetable matter, the fruit of the vine, actually becomes blood through that ritual, so that you're actually consuming blood and flesh during it. They take this quite literally. At the very final scene of the Book of the Short Sun, Patera Remora says to Silk, right before him, he reads him from the Krasmologic writings about how the hyacinth, the wild hyacinth blooms, though it's trod under the shepherd's heel. And this story is about Hyacinthus, where Apollo accidentally kills his lover Hyacinthus, who happens to be male in this particular myth, but that's okay, with a discus. And the blood falls onto the ground, and then it becomes a flower. So you have this transubstantiation where blood becomes vegetable, and vegetable becomes blood. And this is the hybridization that's at the heart of Short Sun. The Inhumi also consume blood, and they parasitize these giant trees because they're actually the liana vines. At the beginning of Ingreen's Jungles, the narrator cuts this vine to make his staff, and later he's capable of performing the astral travel that is only possible with an Inhumi without one there. And they hear this little walking in the night in Dorp, and it's actually just his staff, the liana staff that is the nascent Inhumi, kind of way down on the evolutionary chain. Without the presence of blood, the Inhumi simply are vegetable staffs, right? So when you bury them in the earth, they can survive for a long time because they are, for all intents and purposes, also vegetable in nature, even though they have this sophisticated system of parasitizing both the trees and whatever life they're introduced to. Now, one of the more controversial claims that I'm about to make is that every time that the narrator travels to Earth, he's not traveling through distance, he's traveling through time. The first time he winds up on Earth, this is what he is thinking about, right? Her voice was lost in a babble of others, including Duke Rigolio's. I shut my eyes. I was very tired, which may have helped. While attempting to fix her tones in my memory, I tried to recall Green's jungles and sinew. Sleep rushed upon me, sending me spinning through an endless night. So, they wind up on the Red Sun Whirl, right? Earth, rather than on Green, where he intended to go. And then he says, I tried to sleep after writing those words about sleep, telling myself it was an appropriate place to do so, that I could push this account ahead a bit more in the morning. I want very much to describe the Red Sun Whirl in such a way that you can see it, Nettle, to do it so well that whoever reads this can. Have I made you see Green's jungles, the swamps and their dire inhabitants, the immense trees and the lianas clinging to them like brides, or the city of the Inhumi, a grove of disintegrating towers like a noble face rotting in the grave? And then, you know, they look and they say, wow, this is as ancient as the ruins on Green, but it seems to be our civilization instead of the Inhumi. And at the end of this chapter, he explains how he wound up there. He says, I was thinking about being with my children. I wanted to take us to Green, where Sinew is. I wanted to see him again, as I still do. I wanted you others, you and Duke Spino particularly, and Mora and Echo as well, after they providentially appeared, to see what real evil is, so you might understand why we on Blue must come together in brotherhood before our own world becomes what Green already is. I fell silent, forced to think myself about what I myself had just said. So here we have him thinking about going to Green, and he winds up on Earth instead. But he wants to think about it of a time before the corruption. So he actually, I think, transcends time here, and that giant city of the Inhumi actually is Nisus. And when Horn in Ingreen's Jungles reenacts that scene where he kind of frees that clogged river, right? There's kind of this flooded area. Right? And he cuts up the corpses. They give him this sword, and they also give him a light. This is actually reenacting, I believe, the story of Severian to some degree, where he cuts up the corpses, and then you have this flood coming. It's kind of this symbolic reenactment of that myth that the neighbors allow Horn to kind of reenact. There's a few other things I wanted to go over, though. Encanto, as Silk, the narrator, goes by at certain points, he hears a story about someone who's just like him with a bird who shows up in a past story, right, who tries to warn somebody about being poisoned. And I believe this is another example of him transcending time. Now, a lot of the objections to this are that how possibly could the species have changed so completely in such a short amount of time? And how do we know that they've really transcended time if he can look out there and see, right, the red sun? There's another topic, though, where he actually looks and he can't find the red sun planet when he looks out there at Earth. He looks for it in the sky and he doesn't see it. And that final injunction there, that they'll search the sky for a sign and not find it, Gene Wolfe has done something kind of tricky. You assume that if a planet is going to be Earth, it's going to be blue, and that Severian salvation actually meant something. However, we may actually be seeing the birth of the Hyros, the Vanished People, who are kind of a hybrid of humanity and these sentient trees that have awoken. So one of the last things that I wanted to mention is that another example of this possible time bending occurs when in Dorp, the narrator sees Ox Ghost, he sees Jali looking like Chanel, and he asks very distinctly about the woman that she's preyed upon, right? Where is she? Where is she? And, you know, as far as we know, Jali is still trapped in this basement on green instead of on blue there. And this ring also shows up. And at first the narrator says, this was my ring, this was Horn's ring that was on green. And then he says, no, it wasn't. Well, in these cases, we know that the narrator can't be trusted because he can't recognize the truth, right? Ock repaired the lander, Silk freed them off stage, and they came to blue, where because her children died or because Ock died, Chanel is high on drugs or on rust or whatever drink that she's imbibing, and she's preyed upon by Jali, the Inhumai. And so when Silk comes in there, he mistakes Jali for Chanel. So she's actually been liberated. But this is not very clear at all, and we get that choice to believe. What ring is this? Is this the ring? So you have someone that looks like Chanel, you have Ox Ghost, and you have the ring that was supposed to be on Horn, and a lander that Silk leaves on at the end, all conveniently in this one area. And that's not just coincidence, right? It shows that things are happening off stage. One of the final things that I wanted to talk about here involves this idea that Wolf has attempted to really hide a lot of the actual things that have happened. So this is the final vision of Earth where Severian salvation is not for humanity at all. It's something else. We didn't expect it. And so I'm going to leave you with that thought. Severian salvation, this new sun, was it really for humanity or was it for the winter-killed stalks of new seed, as in eschatology and Genesis? And this is a plan that Wolf enacted from the very first chapter of Shadow of the Torturer, where the new sun engenders life in a brush and it scurries up a tree. Just as Patera Quetzal says that man has climbed up a tree, right, in Long Sun, and he has not yet climbed down. This is the fate, then, of humanity. It's diverged into the Inhumai and into the Vanished People. A pretty bleak and depressing future, but in that first chapter we see that future strains may actually be not as bad as the terrible green environment that we've seen throughout. Thank you so much for listening. Have a great day.